Welcome to edusari.com, your partner in education. In this session, we'll discuss the concept of subject-verb agreement. Subject-verb agreement stresses upon that verb must agree with the subject in number and person. It says that if the subject is a singular, the verb that follows must also be a singular. Whereas, if the subject is plural, the verb must also be plural. For example, in the sentence, gold and silver are precious metals. If I find the subject, I get two subjects, which are gold and silver. Now, since these are two subjects, thus it's a plural subject, and since it's a plural subject, so the verb must also be plural, and the plural verb is are. Since we use the joining word or the conjunction as and, the verb is plural. Now in the sentence, Ram or Shyam stays in hotel, we are using the conjunction as or, which means that either of these, that is one at a time, will stay at the hotel. So since only one is staying at the hotel, we'll use a singular verb which is stays. And if I remove this or and write and, now both of them are staying in the hotel. So it would take a plural verb and thus then it would have been stay. Now we'll discuss some rules that are used to judge what verb should be placed after the subject, whether it should be a singular verb or it should be a plural verb. The first rule says that if two singular subjects are joined with and as in conjunction, the verb must be plural. Now for example, Bob and Martha are eating sushi. Now if I find the subject by asking the question who is eating sushi, I get the answers as Bob and Martha. Since we have two different subjects, that is 1 plus 1 is equal to 2, so we have two subjects, which becomes a plural, so the verb also changes to plural. So I write are instead of is. But if it was just Bob dash eating sushi, so in that case, since it was a singular subject, I would have written Bob is eating sushi. The second rule says that if two singular subjects are joined with or, the verb used is singular. Now if I write the sentence, either Sam or Tina is the monitor of the class, in this sentence, although I have two singular subjects, that is Sam and Tina, so it's one here and one here, but the conjunction used is or. Since it's or, that means not both, but only one between them is the monitor. And since it's only one person who is the monitor, so the verb that would be used should also be singular. And the singular form of are is, so I write either Sam or Tina is the monitor of the class. In another example, it could be Sam or Bob is going to Delhi. Now, kindly note that the verb may change with person, and as the subject verb agreement says that the verb must be concurrent in number as well as person, so we must be aware about the person being talked. Now, for example, I say either Tina or I am going, because since the subject here is I, so I'll write am, because I takes the verb as am. But if the sentence was either I or Tina, so since Tina is the third person, I'll write and any third person takes the verb as is, so I'll write is instead of am. The next rule of subject-verb agreement says that if two singular subjects are joined with, as well as, or along with, the verb used is singular. We must be wary about this thing, that if there are many words written between the subject and the verb, those words have no influence on the choice of the verb. One thing, that verb is always dependent on the subject only. So if it's a singular subject, the verb is singular. If it's a plural subject, the verb is plural. No object will ever influence the choice of the verb. Now, if, for example, I've written Bob as well as Martha is eating sushi. Now, here if I try and find the subject is only Bob. Because if I ask who is eating, the answer is only Bob. And if I ask the question, with whom is Bob eating, the answer would be Martha. And as we know, whom is used in the object cases, so Martha is not a subject but an object. And object has no influence on the verb, so Bob is eating sushi and Martha has nothing to do with the verb. Likewise, Tina along with her mother is going. The reason being, who is going? The subject is only Tina. With whom? The object becomes the mother, and object has no influence on the choice of the verb. So Tina is going. Yes, if I would have written they along with their mother, then the object is singular, but here in this case they is plural, so now the verb would have been are. Likewise, if the sentence was Tina, comma, along with them, again a comma. Now here again the subject is Tina, which is a singular. The number of subjects is one, and objects might be multiple or one. In this case there are many objects because we've written them, but it would not have any effect on the choice of the verb. Since Tina is a singular, so now even here I'll write is going. The next rule for subject-verb agreement says that if a subject is preceded by either, neither, or such indefinite or distributive pronouns, the verb used would be singular. The explanation is simple, that in the case of distributed or indefinite pronoun, we are talking about one at a time. So in the sentence, either of the students in the class is intelligent. Although students is a plural, but either tells that you may select any one among these, that person is intelligent. So since we are choosing only one out of all, so the subject becomes a singular and the choice of the verb is also the singular verb. The next rule says that as we know, certain plurals are treated as singulars, thus the verb used with them would also be singular. Now for example, we have team, group, news, army, school, college. These all are plurals. Now if I say army, it does not mean that I'm referring to only one person, but there are many people. But since it is treated as a singular, that is, I'm referring it as one single entity, I would give it a singular verb. So I say army is on its excavation. Likewise, the news is being telecast. The next rule says that there are certain singulars that are treated as plurals, and thus the verb used with them would also be plural. For example, the things that occur in pair: shoes, socks, spectacles, scissors, trousers, pants. These all are the things that occur in pair, and since they occur in pair, they are referred to be as plurals, and since they are treated as plurals, so the verb given to them or used with them is also a plural. So shoes are designed by Naughty and Derby. Why? Because shoes occur in pair, and since they occur in pair, so we treat them as plurals, and since it's a plural, so it will take a plural verb. The next rule says, the collective proper nouns, that is the collective nouns with a name, are also treated as singulars. Now for example, I say the Indian Army, or the US government, or the Pakistani committee. Now obviously, if I am referring to the US government, now in the government there are many ministers, not only at the central level but also the state level, the district level, and so many people working in the government. So although it's a set of people, but we have given it a single name. And whenever I say US government, it obviously means that I'm referring to all of them. So I've given this whole set or community of people as a name, and since it's a single name, it's being talked about as a single entity, so it becomes a singular. And since it becomes a singular, I'll write it as a singular subject, and the verb given would also be a singular verb. So I say the US government is responsible for the crisis. Another important factor is the error of proximity. It states that in applying the principle of subject-verb agreement, the practice of relying the noun that is closest to the verb to determine whether the verb is singular or plural. In other words, if there are two subjects in a sentence, and one is singular and the other is plural, so the choice of the verb would depend upon the fact that which subject out of the two is near to the verb. So if it is the singular verb that comes near to the verb would change singular, whereas if it is the plural verb that comes near to the verb, so the verb would change to plural. For example, either Gus or his sons have repaired the wreck. Now, we have two subjects, that is Gus and son. Gus, number one, that is, it is a singular subject. Sons, there are many, so it's a plural subject. And the verb is have, so either it should be has here or it should be have. Now, how do I decide whether I write has or have? I'll look which of the two subjects is near to the verb. Here, sons is near to the verb. And sons being a plural would change the verb to be a plural verb. And the plural verb is have. So I write Gus or his sons have repaired the wreck. But in case I write the sentence as either the sons or Gus, now here again, sons is a plural subject, Gus is a singular subject, but now singular subject is near the verb, so I'll write has as the verb. Why? Because has is the singular verb. Likewise, if I say either he or I something, so I'll write am, but either I or he, now I'll write is. The next rule of subject-verb agreement states that the verb is singular if the two subjects are separated by and, but they refer to a same thing. For example, red beans and rice is my mom's favorite dish. Now, I have two subjects here, namely red beans and rice, and they are joined using and as the conjunction, but the both of them are being referred to as a single entity, that is, both of them are one. Since they are referred to as a singular entity, it becomes a singular subject. And since it's a singular subject, I'll write the verb as is. Another example, if I say my friend and benefactor dash absent. Now, here I'm referring to a same person, that is this one person who's my friend as well as he's my benefactor. Now, although there are two subjects, friend and benefactor, but both of them point to one single person. Since they point to one single person, so the subject would be treated as a singular, and I'll write is as the verb. The next rule says that if one of the words each, every, or no comes before a subject, which is a plural subject, the verb would be singular. So if in case I have a plural or a singular subject, but it is preceded by no, each, or every, I'll write the verb as singular verb. For example, no smoking or drinking is allowed. Another example, each student is something. So if I say is absent, yeah, is the defaulter or whatever. So I'll simply write is. Why? Because here all these students are being referred, but I'm writing each with the subject. Since it's written each, so I'll write the verb as a singular verb. The next rule says that if the subjects are both singular and are connected by the words or, nor, neither nor, either or, and not only but also, the verb is singular. In other words, if the subject has the conjunction as the correlating conjunction, either or pair, not only but also pair, as pair, neither nor pair, so in that case the verb would also be would always be a singular verb. For example, Jessica or Christian is to blame for the accident. This, here the correlating conjunction, although it's not mentioned, but obviously the correlating conjunction is either or. And since it's one at the time, and both of them are singulars. Now, one thing, both of them are singulars. Jessica is also singular, Christian is also singular. And the correlating conjunction is either or, so I'll write the verb as the singular verb. Another example, not only Jessica but also Christian is to blame for the accident. That is both of them, but one at a time and using a correlating conjunction. So since it's using a correlating conjunction, I'll use the verb as is, that is the singular verb. Likewise, here in this sentence, either Sam or Anu will attend the conference. Again, the correlating conjunction, and both the subjects are singulars, so they'll take the correlating conjunction, the verb as a singular verb. If both the subjects are plural and connected with the correlating conjunction, the verb would be plural. For example, either dogs or cats. Now, the subjects are dogs, which is a plural, and cats, again a plural. And the correlating conjunction is either or. So now in this case, since both the subjects, even if you choose one among them, it would be a plural subject. And since it's a plural subject, so the verb would be a plural verb. So in a nutshell, if I have to explain, I'll say if we are using a correlating conjunction plus there are two subjects that both of them are singulars, so the verb would be a singular verb. If it's a correlating conjunction plus a plural verbs, then the two subjects are plural verbs, so the verb would be plural. And if it's a correlating conjunction plus one singular verb and one plural verb, so the choice would be dependent on the error of proximity. That is, the subject that comes near to the verb would decide whether the verb is singular or plural. In case we are using the subject with units, such as 10 kilometers, 100 meter, since it's used in units, now for example, if I say, no, units are always used for the reference purposes. Like if I say this is 1 meter, and I say 70 meters or 1 kilometer, this is 1 kilometer, and 70 kilometer means 70 such units kept together. Now for example, this becomes like this, and I have kept them together and I'm looking at them at once, so it becomes 70 kilometers. But I am considering it at once, that is, I'm looking at it as a single entity. Now since I'm looking at it as a single entity, it becomes a singular, and since it becomes a singular, I'll write the verb also as a singular. 70 kilometer is a long distance. Likewise, 80 rupees or $80 or 80 pounds is a big sum. Now, the next rule says indefinite pronouns typically take singular verbs. For example, everybody wants to be loved. Now, here everybody is an indefinite pronoun. It is not pointing to someone, but it is used for everybody in general. And since it's an indefinite pronoun, it will always take a singular verb, which is wants. But there's an exception to the rule. It says that if we use few, many, several, both, all, or some, which are indefinite pronouns as well, we will use plural verbs with them. For example, few students. Yeah, few were left alive after the flood. So if I say, or few students were absent. Few is an indefinite pronoun. I don't know how many of them were absent, but since it is referring to some who were not there, it will take a plural verb. Like with many, several, both. Both again, both means two. Two is a plural, so it becomes a plural verb. Likewise, all also uses the same concept.